So welcome back to the YouTube. This time we are a wee bit fatter than we were before. We're a wee bit less tanned up, because obviously we're not in show prep or on show day anymore. We are in a rebound phase. So this is 4 weeks post show at the time of recording. We are a wee bit fatter. We were a lot heavier. We're about 22 pounds up from stage weight. And as I say, we are not tanned up and oiled up ready for stage. So the look will be a wee bit different. We will show you the look. We're going to go for a push session first. We're at Elite Health and Fitness in Lisburn. Chest focused push session coming up. I'll explain why we're doing things. I'll explain how we're doing things. And then we will do a physique update afterwards just to show the effects of the 4 weeks post show. The food has been high going in, so there's a lot of water weight on board. But it'll be interesting to see just how different it is, obviously, from competing to coming out of competing. And ready to rock. We have got the pre-workout and intra-workout slushies at the ready, so we're going to get them in us and then we'll crack on. So first exercise of the session, first main compound press is a high incline press. So what we're going to do is we're going to get primed and ready for it in a lighter exercise. So basically it's a warm-up set before we actually go on to the movement of the machine as well. So I've had a bit of a stinker because I've got my small cuffs. Ideally, these cuffs would be here. I was going to isolate the chest a lot more because you have a lot less to think about the closer you can get to that base muscle group. So we'll improvise, we'll make do with these. Basically what we're doing is we're getting the whole top line on the go, so we're getting a wee bit of front delt activation and warmed up through that movement, but mostly the upper chest because it's an upper chest movement that we're going into in the high incline next. It is exercises like this where it will be beneficial to have a training partner, especially the heavier you go. As you can see, I can clearly just pull that and get the hooks in, but the closer we get to working weight, that will become more challenging, obviously, because I'm doing it myself. What is important during this is just to make sure that you're taking yourself through the full range of movement, so you're really trying to optimize the stretch at the bottom of the movement and really loosen out those muscles, so you're letting blood flow into the muscle when you're stretching it, and then you're trapping the blood flow in the muscle as you get to the top. So you're really taking it through the full range of movement, priming it ready for that heavy compound up. So one of the realities of coming out of show prep and obviously being able to push extra food is, yes, strength has flew up, yes, performance has been sky high since, probably to the point where I'm stronger now than I was before prep started, but along with that has came the odd wee niggle. So I've had a slight rotator cuff in my left side, and it's been flaring up most push sessions, mostly shoulder focus sessions, so hopefully we're sweet today, but just making sure of it anyway and making sure it is well warmed up before we go into our heavy movements. So exercise one, the main heavy compound of the session is high incline press. Now, got the logbook at the ready. What's good about the logbook is obviously I'm looking back at what I've done last week and I'm trying to either beat it by a rep or add more weight working within that rep range. So I'd have a rep range of 5 to 8. If I got 8 reps last week, then I know I'm adding weight this week. If I haven't yet hit 8 reps, what I'm looking to do is get up to 8 reps, so I'm adding reps rather than weight. Goal on this, last week I got 2 plates. I log weird, but I've got 2.75 plates, which is 57.5 kilo each side. So I'm gonna maintain that weight this week. I've got 6 reps at it, so the goal is this week to get 7 or 8 reps. obviously maintaining everything that went into that set, the likes of form, the likes of good tempo and control of the reps as well, because if that's not all in place, then there's no point in going up and winning reps. The quality of the reps is the most important thing. What is good about this coming out of prep especially is because in this logbook I've got my log from the end of prep, whenever I touched this, and it was two plates aside for 8 reps. So the fact that I've got an extra 15 kilo aside for much the same shows how much the strength is developing, and usually pushes one that doesn't develop just as quickly as the likes of pull or legs. So the fact that this is going up at such a steady rate, buzzing. One of the main reasons as well as to why we're starting with the high incline press is because I think it's the base that people generally start the gym. They will build the chest, but the upper chest will be the lagging part of the chest. More often than not, when people start the gym, they'll just do their basics. They'll do the flat bench press, and maybe do flat dumbbell press, flat machine press. Incline's one of the things that people don't really think about whenever they first start training, so I feel as though whenever people base their... So I feel as though when people build their base physique, it's always the upper chest is lagging. So whenever we're doing chest sessions, the one thing I'll always prioritize is getting that upper chest movement first. Listen to this. So this will be the last warm-up set. This will be probably just 3 reps. And then going into the top set, that's when I get the AirPods in, zone out, and then get aggressive going into that top set. It's good. It's good.
That's nice.
Last week, plus one. That's all I wanted. Absolutely buzzing with that set. There's a graft. Got the plus one rep from last week, which is exactly what we're looking. Took it for 7. Only had 6 last week. Forgot to mention, we've got Samuel behind the camera today. So he's doing a cracking job working on before. Knows what he's doing. And he'll know what I say, what I mean. Shout out Graham for the playlist. Absolute head bangers. So yeah, this one's a nasty one. This is back off set. So we're looking at I got 12 reps of it last week. So targeting 13 plus. So I hate high volume.
Yeah, it's torture.
And I think over 10 reps in my body just starts freaking out.
It's cardio.
Not this week.
What'd you get?
I was 12, so I matched last week, but just not the plus one we're hoping for, but high volume, I hate it. On to flat press now. When we're doing flat press, obviously explain we're prioritizing the high incline first, build the upper chest, because this chest focus day of two heavy chest movements back to back. So this one is going from upper to flat. When you're setting machines like this up, main thing to make sure is just that the handles are level with the chest. The best way of telling this is just making sure the handle's level with nipple line, so you can see that I'm perfectly level there. And what's good about this machine is it slightly converges into the middle. When we look at the top, so you're going from the stretch, and then the chest is well activated when we're up at the top, because what you need to remember with the chest is the role of the chest isn't actually just to push straight forward, it's to go from an outer position to an inward position. So whenever you're doing a press, it's good to start in a stretch and finish with the elbows coming in towards each other there, because that's when the peak amount of blood flow is in the muscle. So you're getting the stretch and you're getting the squeeze, full range of movement. So in regards to warm-up sets, because we've done high incline, there's plenty of blood in my chest right now. I don't need to do just as many warm-up sets as I did on it. The main thing is just getting the feel for the movement before you go in. So I think first warm-up set there was on maybe like a half stack. I think we're close to the full stack at the minute. The goal for the set is to full stack it, add the gin pin, and add 5 kilo. And we're looking to beat 6 or 7 reps on it. See, it's hard to call because I've got this in my shoulder focus day and my chest focus day. So I'm going to be hitting different reps in each of them. I think it was my shoulder focus day on Saturday there that I got for 7 reps, but that was the first exercise on chest, so chest will be a bit fresher in it. I think I got 6 reps of this last week on the chest focus day, so as long as we're above 6 reps today, that's going to be the main goal. In regards to warm up sets, I think I've just done 91 kilo for like 4 reps there. I'll probably just go straight to working set now. Like, I feel ready for it. I know what to expect in terms of weight. It's not going to be a shock whenever that extra weight's on and the mind muscle connection's there, so I'm ready to go. Gym pin ready and plate. I was going to log it as full stack plus 5, but someone's taking a chunk out of that, so I think I'm going to have to put that down as 4.75 kilo. I'll take it. It's 4.5 kilo more than the stack, so we're winning. That happened. Match last week. Just fatigue in the chest at this stage. 98 for 11, so hopefully you get progression there because it didn't in the big lift. So match the 6, 98 back off, I got 11 last time, so 12 to go. Just hit that rep, wasn't happening. 12, matched it. Yeah, plus 1, I'll take it. Got 12. It's a win. So, next exercise we're moving on to is cable lateral raises. Now, it's a different type of tension than you would get from doing dumbbell lateral raises. Right, lateral raises, by the way, just another way of saying side raises, which probably you're more familiar with. Main difference being is we're looking at the biomechanics of the shoulder, and we need to think about when there's most tension on that muscle. So right now, in a cable lateral raise, there's currently tension on my side delt. So the side delt's the target muscle group that we're hitting on this. Not fronts, not rears, it's the side delt that we're working on. And we do that through a lateral motion up the side of the body, level with the shoulder, and then return it back down to the side. So the benefit of this movement is that there's tension on my side delt right now. If, for example, I take this tension off, I'm going to picture a dumbbell in that position, There's absolutely no tension on the side delt right now. And dumbbells are more a fight against gravity than tension. So there's only starts to become tension on the side delt when in dumbbell movement, once you hit about this 45 degree angle up to the 90. And it's only really that. So it's for the peak point, which is up at the top, the peak point of tension, dumbbells are very useful. They'll always have a place in the plan, but I do feel as though there's a lot more advantages to doing it in a cable setting for lateral raises. When we are doing these, we'd always prefer to do them double arm rather than single arm. I feel as though unilateral work, again, everything can have its place in a plan, but when we do unilateral work, what you need to consider is if you are isolating the muscle group to the best possibility. Usually what happens when we do single arm exercises is that you will compensate towards that side. So for example, if I were just doing my right side here, I would probably maybe start a wee bit lower and there would be a wee bit of momentum comes in to get that rep up. Whereas when you're doing both arms at the same time, it means that both arms have to be treated equally in order to be able to do those reps. It's a warm up set, which is why I'm speaking through it. It's the working set I wouldn't be able to. And we're just gonna take it for a good 8-10 reps. This is the first shoulder focused exercise in the plan today, so we're just getting plenty of blood flow in before we go into a working set. And then we've got two chest exercises still left to do, and then with another side delt variation. So we're just splitting up the shoulder work so that we're not doing, you know, side raises for three sets and then straight into more side raises for three sets. So we're going to do two heavy sets now and a high rep set, and then in the dips, pec deck, and then we're back into another side delt variation, which is the dumbbell variation. One thing I forgot to mention about the side raises, the reason for cuffs rather than using the likes of a D-handle is just for my muscle connection. So you want to break down the barriers between the lever itself and the actual force. So when I'm applying force, all I'm thinking about is using my side delt to raise that weight. Whereas if I'm gripping a D-handle, it's just a wee bit of a thought process to actually grip that D-handle, and then that engages the forearms and engages other muscle groups, rather than just side delt. So it's just that wee bit more isolation that helps that mind-muscle connection. You'll feel the movement that wee bit more. The other thing you'll notice is the height that I've got it set up. You see it's almost pretty much perfectly level with where I'm pulling from. I'm not pulling from the floor and going up like that, because that encourages the traps to come into play to actually raise the weight upward. The focus is going sideways, not upward. So again, that's why we have the benefit of having dumbbell side raises in as well, because the focus of the dumbbell side raises is to get that lockout at the top. The focus on this is to push outward, and we're focusing on that side delt pushing outward.
Rachel is happily scratching an instant ticket from the Illinois Lottery. So even though the landscapers landed a tree in her living room, Rachel's brushing it off because she knows anyone could win in an instant. Play today. Be smart, play smart. Be smart, you're older than you.
Chin. Get some dips though. So, on the dips, now since prep, especially with the shoulder, basically what's been happening in sessions, especially chest sessions, because this is like third or fourth chest exercise, by the time I get to this, I've got an unbelievable pump. And what that's caused is to flare up that rotator cuff. So by the time I get this stage in the workout, dips have been deadly, whether it's because I've got that muscle pump and the fatigue in the muscle is extreme. I literally started this going back to dips of body weight. Now bear in mind, on prep I would have been adding maybe, I got up to like 45-50 kilo adding to my body weight. Today I go to body weight dips for like 6 reps. I think shows you the level of fatigue that's hitting in the workout. Recent weeks, rotator cuff has flared up going into this, obviously because it's going down and getting a stretch in that peak position. So we're taking that consideration. Now last week was the best week I've had, and we're using the belt spot for this. So what we'll do is we've got this age, we're adding 15 kilo to obviously the body weight, and I managed it for like 15 reps. So hopes are high in terms of the fact that I'm coming out of that wee spell where they weren't going too well. Goal for today is add 10 kilo to that, because 15 reps, the rep range is 6 to 9. So should be adding 10 kilo to that. Hopefully we'll get 25 kilo on. Again, warm up sets in this. Just because that rotator cuff, I will take nice and easy, nice and slow. Probably go body weight into the actual belt squat itself, which is quite heavy, and then adding the weight onto that. Quite heavy actually. Don't know whether it's down to tightness or actually just fatigue in the muscle at this stage, but we'll judge as we go. Probably go for that added 15 kilo, see what it's like a couple of reps in. If it's challenging, we'll just take that for a working set again. Before going this set, I do want to address, I know how stinking that is to look at. The fact that there's a plate on one side and not the other, but it does my OCD, but let's be real, it doesn't matter if there's weight on one side, not the other, because it all gets lifted the same. It's not a unilateral exercise, so relax. Don't come at me for it. I'll take good rest before the set and just make sure strength's a priority. And then match it next week. We'll match it. I'm kind of chasing weight a wee bit more in this exercise than I am in most, just because I want to get back to where I was. Whereas usually it's just kind of the case of getting an extra 5 kilo, maybe an extra rep or two. But I know I'm capable of a lot more in this, so I'm going to take a good rest, good 2-3 minutes before this next set, and then make sure strength is a priority so that we can then try and match that next week. After that, we'll take that at 7. So perfectly within that range, rep range 6 to 9. So perfectly within it, 25 kilo plus the belt squat itself. So it's something to work off for next week. We'll try and increase the reps. Once we get 9 reps of that, it's plus 30. And we're pretty much back where we were. Bodyweight squats, or squats, belt squat. Dips before, it was plus 40, 45 kilo. Plus body weight, I wasn't using the belt squat. There is a bit of weight in that belt squat, so all things considered, pretty happy with that. Back to where we were, pre-prep. Probably my favourite back deck machine that I've used. That's for the same reason as we use the cuffs in side raises. Same reason we use cuffs in most exercises. It is to take the actual thought process out of it. The closer we can get to the chest in terms of resistance, the more that the chest is going to work on its own, rather than other muscle groups coming in. So when you're usually doing pec deck, for example, what you have to think about when you're holding the bars and going into there is actually to keep your arm locked out and make sure that it's the elbows coming in that's going to squeeze, because doing a pec deck like that, the chest isn't fully activated there. Although you feel like you're getting handles together, it's not really doing anything for the chest because the tension is out here where the elbows are. Whereas whenever you're using this and your elbows are hooked around the pad, you're getting that stretch, and then the elbows have to come together to bring that pad together, and that's when you know you're getting the peak amount of blood flow in the chest and the best squeeze. I think it's brilliant. It's probably, as I say, probably the best machine I've used for a back deck. So, second set of pec deck, and this is a pivotal set. So, a pivotal set is where you're looking to hit failure between 10 and 12 reps. You give yourself 15 to 20 seconds rest, and then you're keeping the weight the same, going in again. If you did hit failure between 10 and 12 in that first set, you should be hitting failure between 6 and 8 reps the second set. Pivotal set is where then at the end of those 6 to 8 reps, you're looking to squeeze at the peak point of the rep and hold for 5 to 6 seconds. So that's what we're going for this set. Weight-wise, we're going 36, just light. Personally, on pec deck, I've always went light, but just because I feel it a lot more. As I say, the purpose of pec deck is to squeeze those elbows together. I don't want to be doing those last couple of reps where I'm kind of only getting to like there and counting it as a rep. I want to get that good range of movement when I'm doing it. So, main points for that, we did discuss it over there when we were doing the cuff laterals. What you'll notice in that set is I'm spending a wee bit more time at the top of the rep, because as I say, it's when the peak amount of tension is on the side delt when we're using dumbbells, because it's gravity that we're fighting against. That's going to be the point where there's more tension. So it's about keeping it strict and holding it for a second up there. Always recommend doing these seated, because a wee bit of cheating form can come in naturally. Whenever we're doing the standing, so when we're doing the standing, you'll notice that the knees maybe jerk a wee bit, and just to get that wee bit of momentum up, so it's taking the tension off that phase there, and then the dumbbells are gaining momentum on the way up, that's more catching them. So definitely staying seated against the bench if you can, just keeping yourself as upright as possible, and spend that wee second at the top of each rep. So on the triceps, whenever we're doing a pull-down movement with the triceps, the most important thing is to keep the elbows still as possible. The movement, as we go from there to there,
That's your lats. So your lats are going to be doing that movement. That's a pull movement. That's a rowing movement that you're more likely doing in your pull-up. So what we want to do as soon as we bring the cable down is get into that position as soon as possible. So whenever that elbow stays still, there's only one muscle group that can move the weight from A to B, and that's the tricep. So you're stretching the tricep there, and you're squeezing it there. You're taking the tricep through its full range of movement, and you're isolating the tricep so there's no other muscle groups coming into play. So as we put it down, elbows tight, level this side, and then we'll move. Squeeze. Stretch the tricep, and squeeze the tricep. What you'll notice as well is the fact that I'm spending a second at the bottom of the rep as well. Because that's the peak point of tension in the tricep. So not a case of just bringing the weight down, getting there, and letting go. Slow and controlled the whole way through. Keep that second squeeze at the bottom. Trap as much blood in the muscle as you can.
All right, let's go in.
So push session wrapped up, that is it done. We'll get a quick physique check here. I will put the stage trunks back on for the first time bar Saturday's check-in since show day. So I will be looking different. As much as it seems, and obviously this is what I do in terms of updating physique and bodybuilding and such as that, but this is probably one of the one times that I've been a wee bit self-conscious about doing it on camera, because I know that it looks a lot different. I know there's a lot of water being held, my waist isn't half as tight as it was come show day. It's almost a kind of expectancy that people have, because obviously they've seen photos of me and it's only like four weeks ago now. In the best shape of my life, and then obviously I'm not going to look like that now, so it's almost like that kind of standard that I've set for myself. But that's the purpose of this video, is to show you the journey that goes on behind the scenes in order to look like that and look better than that next year. So this is the important time, it's where we grow. This is where things will get ugly over the coming months, but I will keep myself accountable by continuing to do this on screen to show you that process and show you what needs to happen in order to build muscle, especially in the places that we want to build it most. I know that I finished off the last video by saying I'm going to win a junior title in bodybuilding last year, and that is what this season of the series of YouTube videos is about. This is statement season, episode one, taking you through a push session physique update, and I'm going to hold myself accountable by saying I'm going to do these videos every 4 to 6 weeks throughout my off season and keep you updated in the loop of how things are going. To keep things according to plan year round, to keep myself obviously accountable, as I say, to set that higher standard for myself going into this year. I've set a serious goal, I've set a big goal, and obviously it's up to me to get there. So this is one of the methods that I'm using, is to keep myself accountable on this platform. And show you the journey as well, show you exactly what's going on behind the scenes to get me there, and hopefully in the end that is the result that we come out with. So I'm going to get changed, and when I come back I will be half naked. Mm-hmm. It's so much more tiring than it was
yeah,
a few weeks ago. It's not as pretty as it was the last time that YouTube would have seen it, but it is what it is. It's what needs to be done. Points to bring up. Lats in that shot and arms. So back and arms are the two main points. I think I've got a good back in the sense of lat spread, back and front. I think that proportion is quite good. But I said myself before going into the show, that needs a lot more V taper to it. It needs to be a lot broader, especially from the back when I'm hitting the back double bicep. And in terms of changes to the plan going forward, we're hitting glutes 3 times a week. Everywhere else in my body. Now I know glutes on a male and female is the last bit of body fat to go on a body. It's just where the part of the body that holds fat the most. So to make that easier going into next off season, because my glutes are still holding fat come stage time, is we're gonna grow bigger glutes. And a bigger muscle group will be easier to get shredded. So we'll get that conditioning that wee bit easier next year if we do grow the glutes in the off season. So hitting them 3 times a week, extra volume on them, total of 6 working sets per week, but a lot of volume in terms of low volume sets, high volume sets. So they're getting hit hard. Obviously they're getting hit subconsciously in leg exercises and a few pulls as well. So plan going forward is in place. It's just about me sticking to it and sticking accountable. And as I say, this series here is gonna do a lot of that for me. So can you expect a video every 4 to 6 weeks? I'm gonna get uglier and uglier whenever I do these rounds, but it's the part of the process that needs to happen, and what I feel that needs to be seen as well, because as I say, I did not feel overly confident coming on camera doing this right now, and I'm sure a lot of people are not really understand that, but coming from the condition that I was in to then the condition now in such a short space of time, because when you're on prep you see these changes of improvements coming almost daily in those last 4 or 5 weeks, and then it's unfortunate that the adverse effect is coming out of prep those 4 or 5 weeks. You know, you're starting to see wee striations leave, wee bits of vascularity leave the body day by day, week by week, and that can have a big mental effect. As I say, I feel as though the standards that other people have set, because they've seen me on stage in such a short space of time, to then see me walking about the gym 3 weeks later, and maybe I've just had a meal and I'm sitting there with a big fucking bloat in my belly. It's what it is. But as I say, I'll come back next year stronger for it. So I'm gonna do good in the long run. I'm gonna put clothes back on. Hopefully you guys have enjoyed this video. Hopefully it has educated you slightly in terms of train and push, in terms of the process for an off season, successful off season, which I'll show to be successful obviously at the end of it. But yeah, hopefully you guys enjoyed. And that'll do us there. Thank you for watching.